Well, it's a real pleasure to be here. I did not bring my point shoes or my tutu, but so I'm going to start with a confession. When Patty told me that I had to give a talk, I thought, oh, a talk, slides, this is what I typically do. And she said, no, a TED talk. And I'm thinking, I've actually never seen a TED talk before. But I was talking about this at home, and my son, who is 8, he said to me, Mommy, it's only 10 minutes. So I'm a pediatric oncologist. I co-direct the Pediatric Hematologic Malignancy Program here. I also take care of children with cancer in the Jimmy Fund Clinic. And I run a research laboratory that's focused on identifying new drug targets and ultimately new drugs for a number of cancers that affect children. I've been here since medical school, so it's a long time. I'm not going to tell you exactly how long. And I stayed, and that's because I love this place. I don't think that there is a better place for taking care of patients with cancer or for doing cancer-focused research. This place is just phenomenal. And I'd like to tell you about some of our efforts today in pediatric oncology. I'm going to start, though, with the messages that I'd like you to walk away with today. The first is that the war is not over in pediatric cancer. We tend to think of, oh, pediatric cancer, we're doing great. But there's a fact that I want to share with you. Cancer is the leading cause of death by disease in children. Many people don't know that. The war is hardly over. And we're still identifying what are the problems. We use very powerful drugs to treat children with cancer. We're really just now beginning to understand what are the consequences of these drugs over the ages. And Lisa Diller, who's here today, is really leading these efforts and teaching us what are the toxicities of our therapy. We need to do better. We need to cure all children, and we need to decrease the toxicity. The second thing is we think pediatric cancers are rare, right? And that's true. But pediatric cancer research teaches us an awful lot about cancer more broadly. And I'm going to explain to you today how that's the case. And then finally, while we have a lot of work to do, I'm really optimistic. The technologies that have been developed in the last several years really are unparalleled in the history of cancer discovery. And I think these technologies are going to allow us to make tremendous progress in the next decade. And so what I'd like to do is I'd like to take a step back in honor of Sidney Farber and really start in the 1940s. And I'm going to focus most of my comments on childhood leukemia, which is the most common cause of cancer in children. So it was the 40s. Leukemia was incurable. And Dr. Farber had the idea that if we took these powerful drugs and we used them in combination, that perhaps then we could engender more long-term remissions. And he did that, and he did that in kids first, in kids with leukemia. And I think this is a great example of how a study that was done in children has really informed how we treat almost all patients with cancer today. This idea that one drug is not enough, that we need to use drugs in combination. And over the years, we've done that in pediatrics. We've done that by taking drugs, figuring out which diseases are sensitive to which drugs, using them in combination, and we've done actually quite well. We've gone for childhood leukemia from a cure rate of 0% in the 40s, now to close to 90%. But there's still a problem, and that's that leukemia is the second leading cause of cancer-related death in children, because it's the most common cause of cancer in kids. So the fight is not over. And I think a question is, how are we going to continue to innovate? How are we going to make progress for all children and adults with cancer? And I'd like to share with you a few ideas of how I think this is going to happen and how it's happening and being led by researchers at the Dana-Farber. The first you heard about from Levi, and this is the idea of precision medicine. Can we figure out what the changes are in an individual patient's tumor and then match those changes to drugs? Can we use molecular features of cancer to better guide therapy? And we're doing this now. We're doing this, as Levi said, and I want to share with you two of my favorite examples in childhood cancer of how this has actually been shown to be possible and successful. And the first was a study that was done here that was led by Lewis Silverman and Linda Ruman. This focused on the following idea. We take children with leukemia. We treat them with very powerful drugs, but a subset of them relapse, and how can we figure out what that subset is? So at the end of a month, most of the children, well over 95%, they're in remission when we look under the microscope. So we said, well, what if we could figure out how to detect leukemia that's below the level of the microscope? I call it submicroscopic. Dr. Silverman calls it invisible leukemia. And so we developed a technology for doing that. And we found out that at the end of a month, if a child had high levels of submicroscopic or invisible leukemia, their chance of cure was much lower. And so we said, well, what if we went back to the days and the thoughts of Dr. Farber, and we started adding new drugs, different drugs, to the treatment of those children? And what we found, and this is hot off the presses, is that for those children, their leukemia-free survival went from 30 to 40% now to about 75%. And that's just in the last couple of years. A second example, there's a subset of childhood ALL. That's rare, but it's a problem. And this is a subset where the children have a very specific change in their leukemia called the BCR-ABL gene rearrangement. And this leads to the production of the BCR-ABL protein, which is cancer-promoting. These children used to get bone marrow transplants, and we know there's a lot of toxicity from transplant. Now, we can identify those children, and we can give them chemotherapy and a pill that inhibits BCR-ABL. And you may have heard of this pill called Gleevec. These children no longer get bone marrow transplants. It's dramatically changed how we treat them. So moving forward, what else are we doing? There's a trial that was led, one of the first in the country, by Katie Janeway, who's here, that did just what Levi described. She characterized the changes in children with solid tumors and then said, can we map those changes to drugs? And now working with Katie, we're going to bring this to children with leukemia as well at the Dana-Farber and in programs across the country. What else do we have to do? We have to find new targets. And I think this is a great example where childhood cancers really inform us about cancers very broadly. When I was in med school, I was taught, you know, cancer, you need lots of changes in the genes to cause a cancer. We're sequencing these childhood cancers, and what we're finding is that in most of them, there are actually very few changes that you need in the genes to cause these cancers. And so what that means is that those changes are very likely to be important. And if we study those changes, we can learn a lot about what those changes are, how do they promote cancer, can we make drugs against them? And it's harder to do this in adult cancers. Over time, you accumulate lots of changes in the genes, and it's hard to figure out which of those changes are the ones that are critical to the cancer versus which of them are just bystanders, kind of along for the ride, were caused by the cumulative toxicity of life over time. And so we can learn about those genes and their importance by studying pediatric cancer. And I bring you an example. One of my areas of interest is a tumor called Ewing sarcoma. And we found by sequencing this tumor that there were very few changes, but there was a change in a gene in about 15 to 20% of children. And what we found is that the change in the gene seemed to be associated with metastasis. So last night when I'm preparing for this, it's about 1 a.m, and I see this pop up in my email, and it's data. Scientists love data. So I open the email, and it's data from a study where we knocked down this gene, and we looked at what did it do in mouse models, and what we found is that the mice that have lost this gene, their Ewing sarcoma seems to be traveling to the lungs. And so this is very exciting times for us. But we've got to make drugs, right? We find these new targets, we've got to make drugs, and how are we going to do that? Pediatric cancers are rare. It's much harder to excite the pharmaceutical community to make drugs against the targets that we see in our tumors. And this is where folks like Jay, that you're going to hear from later, are critical, where we can work together now in an academic center with brilliant chemists like Jay Bradner and others to make drugs against targets and to really test them in peds. And we're doing this. And there's an example that I love to mention, work that we did with Jay. Jay's lab had developed a molecule. We had a conversation outside of an elevator about whether this compound might be relevant in neuroblastoma. We tested it in our labs, we tested it in models, and now we have a clinical trial that's been written that we hope will open within the next year. So it's very powerful what you can do in a collaborative environment where you have chemists, you have biologists, you have clinicians, all adjacent working collaboratively. And I want to end, and I'm going to save this, immunology, to me another very exciting area that Steve is going to talk about, I think, next. So I want to tell you, I was on call very recently through Tuesday night, and every time I go on call, I am humbled and reminded of why we are doing this, that the fight really isn't over. There are kids that we're not curing, and we need to. And at the same time this night, I got an email from a patient of mine. She sent me an ultrasound of her 34-week-old developing baby who's going to be born in a few weeks, and that's the other side of why we do this. I'm a ballerina. Ballerinas are known for being perfectionists. We have to cure 100% of kids, and that's why we're here today. We can't do this without help. And that's all I have to say today. Thank you.